presentation on the topic, how is Hyperloop the future of transportation? So before we begin on the discussion that what is Hyperloop in your understanding, I would like to show you all a small video that will be giving you an introduction to the topic Hyperloop.
Is a new form of mass transportation that will set the standard for 21st century travel by connecting cities in minutes. It starts with a near-vacuum environment inside a tube, which enables high speeds and low power consumption by nearly eliminating aerodynamic drag. Inside that tube, battery-powered pods glide at speeds up to 670 miles per hour. Comfortably, safely, and quietly, using our proprietary magnetic levitation and propulsion. After building and testing the world's first Hyperloop system, we are now focused on our commercial product. The key to our product is guided by a design that is elegant through its simplicity, future-proof due to its modularity, and guided by the principles of this century, not the last. To do this, we moved levitation, power, and propulsion onto the pod. Our proprietary levitation engines make Hyperloop 10 times more efficient than the world's fastest maglev trains today. The engines contain arrays of electromagnets, which lift and guide the pod within the track. Hyperloop also supports on-demand service and high throughput by having pods travel in convoys. Unlike train cars, pods are not physically connected, which allows for individual pods to have different destinations. Just like a car taking an off-ramp, pods can split off while the rest of the convoy continues on. The absence of moving parts on the track and the advantage of levitation and guidance on top of the pod allows for high-speed switching and convoy to take place seamlessly. These next-generation innovations not only enable ultra-fast speeds, but provide on-demand, direct-to-destination service, carrying tens of thousands of passengers per hour, per direction, at airplane speeds with zero direct emissions. Fast, effortless journeys that expand possibilities. This is Virgin Hyperloop.
Transportation device, which is,
so we can say it is modern?
Yes, it is modern.
It is modern. Is modern form of
transportation.
We can say mass transportation because
high speed
people are using it. Modern form of is a modern form of mass transportation. Now, what is the Hyperloop having? Rohan?
What can it be?
Hyperloop is a modern form of mass transportation. What it comprises of?
Its structure?
Yeah, what is there inside a Hyperloop?
Inside a Hyperloop is shaped like a capsule.
Capsule shaped pod. Can you say that?
Pod.
Pod. A mass transportation that consists of a capsule-shaped pod. Now, what is that capsule-shaped pod doing? What is it doing? It's running at
high speed.
That runs at high speed. In what kind of environment? What's the environment inside that particular
vacuum?
Near vacuum environment. That runs at high speed in a near vacuum environment. And how is it sustainable?
Because it's electric power.
Electric power, or we can say zero direct emissions. That runs in a near vacuum environment
with zero direct emissions.
With zero direct emissions and what is it capable of doing? Neva. High speed is it? So, in a near vacuum environment without releasing zero emissions and has the ability to connect cities within minutes because it's running at high speed, so it wouldn't take much time. And has the ability to connect cities within minutes. Anything else apart from this? This is what a hyperloop is. Has anyone got any other point other than this? What a hyperloop could have that I might have missed? Stations? Not exactly stations. What is a hyperloop basically?
Main
what of take a hyperloop. If you want to call that run, that is magnetically levitated. That is magnetically levitated and runs at high speed in a near vacuum environment without releasing direct emissions in the atmosphere and has the ability to connect cities within minutes. So this was a basic overview of what is a hyperloop. These are all the same things, the point that I told you. Now, why is Hyperloop so high? Now, I'll be showing you a few factors that are helping to hype up the Hyperloop. The first one being speed. Now, to gain high speed, there are two villains, you could say, of speed that oppose getting high speed. One is ground friction. The second is aerodynamic drag. If you are able to eliminate these two villains of speed, we are going to get high speeds. Now, let's see about hyperloop. Hyperloop is magnetically levitated. Over here, you can see. Somewhat like this, over here you have these kind of lines of magnets and over here you have a series of magnets. I'll be explaining how magnetic levitation works in the following slide. Over here you have one, over this side you have one. Here, and over here. These four places you have these magnets. And over here also magnets are connected in series, north pole south pole. I'll be explaining how that works. So by magnetically levitating things, you are first of all eliminating ground friction or reducing it significantly. Secondly, how do you eliminate aerodynamic drag? By creating a near vacuum environment. So they have created a near vacuum environment that is equivalent to 2 lakh feet above the sea level. Like it's almost near vacuum. That's you could say 95% to 97% vacuum and the rest is a little bit of air. So you are eliminating both these things, ground friction through magnetic levitation and aerodynamic drag by creating a near vacuum environment inside the tube. And this is the reason why it is able to attain 1080 km per hour speed within 5 minutes. So the speed is attained by eliminating ground friction and aerodynamic drag. Talking about sustainability. When I say Hyperloop is modern, anything that has to be modern needs to be sustainable. Because at this point of time, sustainability is required when anything is said to be modern. Now, Hyperloop, though it says that it uses very low energy consumption, but still, it is in comparison to the competing systems and the maglev trains that we are having right now. It is not low, it's still quite high. Now, if you want to make this sustainable, what Hyperloop systems have done, right? This is a tube in which the Hyperloop is running. And on top of it, you have the solar panel connected. Now what these solar panels are doing, that when Hyperloop is running in a near vacuum environment, these solar panels can generate electricity for Hyperloop. So how is it sustainable? By using solar panels, you are reducing your dependency on forms of electricity that are derived from thermal power, coal and different things. So this is quite sustainable, because in the near future, sustainability is the main key to success. So you need to be sustainable if you want to be the future. System operations, this is quite a small topic, it's a bit of scientific topic, I'll just quickly go through it. Suppose you are starting from point A. Point A is, suppose Vadodara. We are starting from Vadodara. Now, you want to travel to a different location. Suppose you want to go to Mumbai, you take this spot, you can go to Mumbai. If you want to go to Delhi, you can take another pod that goes to Delhi. And if you want to go to some other city, you take another line. Now, how this is quite beneficial, because suppose you take Rajdhani Express to Mumbai. That's the simplest example. Now, you start off from Vadodara, the train gains some speed and you stop at Surat. After Surat, the train will gain some speed, it will again stop at Kulabiya Central. After that, it will reach Borivali, after that, it will reach Mumbai Central. But because you don't have this kind of signals and because pods are not physically connected as you saw in the video. So from one location, 2 to 3 pods or even greater than this, like in this example there are 2 to 3 pods, are starting from one single point and they are capable of going to different locations. I told you I will be explaining magnetic levitation, how it is working. So propulsion I will be explaining with a simple diagram that's more relevant to Hyperloop. First we should see levitation. Now the basic principle of magnetism is when right poles come together, that is north and north pole and south pole. When these two poles, like light poles, come together, they repel. But when unlike poles come together, like north south and south north, they attract. Okay, so this is basic. So over here, as you can see, we have one magnet over here, one over here, one at the top, and one over here. So what is happening? As you can see, it is NN. NN. Now what is this? NN means North Pole and North Pole. And over here you also have North Pole and North Pole. Now these are not so chutka wala magnets that you get at the stationary shop. These are high power magnets, they have high magnetism. That's why they are being able to lift such a heavy train along with the passengers. So what is happening over in the city is that light poles, over here you have North Pole, here also North Pole, North Pole, North Pole. So, when two light poles come in contact, they repel each other. Now, when I say they repel, I mean they go far away from each other. So that is the thing that's happening over here. These powerful magnets are repelling each other. And the train is, you could say, mounted a little bit so that it doesn't fall. Because when you bring two magnets that are repelling each other, if you would have ever done this little experiment, the top one always falls down. It always topples down. So in order to avoid the toppling down of the train itself, you have it mounted a little bit. It has a little bit of support on the tracks. Because of this kind of thing. And there are repelling, so the train is levitated and it is also stable, it's not toppling. Now I'll explain propulsion to you with this simple diagram. So this was about levitation, this is about propulsion. Now how is propulsion working? Suppose this is the hyperloop, this is the body of the hyperloop. This hyperloop signifies the direction in which the hyperloop is proceeding. Over here I told you there are, you know, those line kind of a things where you have the magnets connected in series, like you could say south pole, north pole, south pole, north pole. Below also, but a little bit of difference is, and inside the hyperloop also you have two magnets. Each side two magnets, a total of four magnets. They are connected as north pole, south pole, south pole, north pole. Now what is it doing actually? This is the, you know, the levitated line, and over here we have the hyperloop. South pole and the south pole, they are like poles. So what is happening? Repulsion, as you can see, this arrow is going far away. So repulsion is happening. Okay? From the same over here also, north pole and the north pole. So again repulsion is going to happen. Again repulsion is happening. Now these magnets, both the sides, the combination of the magnets are having equal magnetism. Or is it one side is more powerful than the other? What will happen?
One side
will move towards one side. So both are of equal power, that's quite important. So over here we have repulsion, and of equal, because of the equal power from the back, it is getting pushed a little bit forward. Now at the front, you see the same kind of a scenario. It is a little bit closer, but it's a little bit back. So south pole and the north pole, what's happening? Attraction. So north pole is over here. So they are attracting. And south pole and the north pole, again, unlike poles, so they are attracting. But at the same time, they are repelling. Repulsion is happening over here. See over here. So what is happening? That the train is being pushed from the back. It is being pushed from the back and is being attracted from the front. It is being pushed and attracted from the front. And now you will be having a question that when repulsion will be happening from the front, that train should be moving in the opposite direction. That's a simple question that's open, right? So that doesn't happen because a series of attraction and repulsion is happening. When repulsion will be there and attraction will be here, the south and north pole will come, and again attraction from the back and repulsion from the front. So this is the way, by a series of repulsions and attractions, the train is able to move through a magnetically levitated system.
Can we get serious now?
Yes, can we get serious now? All the factors I showed you that help in building up the hyperloop will all be minor if the factor that I am going to show you after this slide is not present. Can anyone guess what that factor is?
Vacuum?
Correct. That factor is vacuum. Now, importance of vacuum in hyperloop. Now, they have created a vacuum environment equal to 2 lakh feet or the sea level. Now, why would someone want to create so much of that?
To reduce
aerodynamic drag. Now before I talk about aerodynamic drag, just look at this shape. Is this shape a little bit like this? Is this shape aerodynamic?
No.
No, means poorly aerodynamic or quite good?
Poorly.
It's poorly aerodynamic. This shape is poorly aerodynamic. So what will happen in case over here you have little vacuum, this is near vacuum environment. So almost you have 95 to 97% of vacuum over here and a little bit of 2 to 3% of air over here. So there is only one arrow. This is the aerodynamic drag that is acting on the hyperloop. because then one person also might be traveling back a little bit. So it is magnetically radiated. So what is happening over here? Ground friction eliminated, and because of near vacuum environment, you are eliminating aerodynamic drag also, because this shape is not at all aerodynamic. And if you want to achieve greater speed with power consumption that is low, you need to eliminate air and the aerodynamic drag, because aerodynamic drag is nothing but that is opposing your motion. You want to move this side, but it is opposing your motion. It's same as ground friction, but this is a fluid. Drag is basically a fluid, like air and liquid. So it is opposing your motion, and if it is opposing your motion, if you have to cut through it, you need to get some energy. Now over here, if you are having just 2-3% of air, then that is not harming anything. Like, see, you have the big pump shown here, like 2 lakh feet above the sea level. Lower the aerodynamic drag significantly, allowing for higher speeds to be achieved by using minimal energy. The same thing I told you earlier. Now we take a hypothetical situation. Now we'll be taking a hypothetical situation. This is hypothetical. We are replacing near vacuum conditions, that is 95-97% vacuum, with air. Now in this scenario, you are having only 1-2% of vacuum, and the rest 99-98% you are having air inside the tube. Suppose there is a breach inside the tube. The pumps are not working from somewhere the gas was able to, the air was able to get leaked inside. In the previous image, there was only one arrow, this one. But over here, as you can see, there are similar not many arrows. Now these not many arrows are signifying greater aerodynamic drag. Like I said before, this shape is not at all aerodynamic. This is aerodynamic, but poorly aerodynamic. How do you expect this kind of a shape to produce this much of aerodynamic drag, that too using a low power consumption? It's not possible. If this has to produce a lot of aerodynamic drag, then it has to increase the power consumption. At least to get some, like the speed that is promised, 1080 km/h. That will result in a lot of power consumption. That is why they have replaced air conditions with near vacuum conditions, so that at a lower power consumption they can get high speeds. And that is what makes Hyperloop the future of technology. Thank you.
Okay, Dayan, in this Hyperloop system, how will you create the vacuum?
The vacuum environment is basically created by using these pumps. You have these are very strong powered pumps.
What is this?
This is basically a pump, sir. If you remove this, I think this structure is quite visible.
Is it tube?
This is a high powered pump, sir. Inside this tube, this is the Hyperloop tube, first of all, over here. You are having normally like 99% of over here and a little bit of vacuum, negligible amount of vacuum. What this pump is doing is, you have the tube, what we are doing, we are trying to prevent as much air, as least air to get inside this tube. And we are sucking out all the air from this particular tube by using these pumps. And these are strong power pumps, and they are continuously working.
So when we remove all the airs inside this tube, then there is no any effect of atmospheric pressure on that tube.
Okay. So that is, there is also on near vacuum environment over here, and inside the tube you have a normal environment. So it's, the tube is actually pressurized. When, like your sir, your question, there is another question. When planes are flying at 35,000 feet, why don't they burst? Because there's a lot of pressure difference added. Like the plane is normal pressurized equivalent to the ground, and over there you have a very low pressure. Over here you are having a very low pressure, but we are having pressurized environment inside the hyperloop. So when hyperloop is pressured, the environment, because the design on the hyperloop is such.
When it is a near vacuum environment, you told that a vacuum is the most important feature for it to attain that high speed with sustainable power consumption. So why is it not aerodynamic? If there is a breach in the environment, just like you said, it will cause the vacuum to fill up. So why don't they make the pod aerodynamic? Even if it will be able to some extent it will be able to cope up with that vacuum.
Okay.
And as it is a near vacuum environment, then only 1-2% air is still present. So why don't they have aerodynamic?
When you are creating a near vacuum environment, yeah, I am understanding. You are saying that this is the shape that is poorly aerodynamic. Why don't you make this kind of something
proper aerodynamic?
Then what is the point of calling it a hyperloop? This kind of shape, aerodynamic shape, you get to maglev print. They are not running in a vacuum environment, but still they are gaining some high speed. Then what is the point of having a hyperloop? Because see, first you are creating a near vacuum environment. It is capable of going at high speed. It is sustainable. But in case there is a small breach in the tube or some amount of air can get inside the tube, the pod will just use a little bit of more energy, not quite high, but a little bit of more energy to glide safely to the next destination. Or if there is a bigger breach in the tube, the pod can just stop safely inside the tube and the passengers can evacuate if they need to. Yes, I am not telling you, this is told by the CEO of Virgin Hyperloop Company, George Gates.
So why don't they just make a vacuum in maglev in a vacuum?
So this is maglev in a vacuum only, but
why not aerodynamic?
First of all, breaches don't happen all the time. When you are creating such an expensive system, to remove all the air, quality tubes, then breaches are not going to happen every now and then. So you are creating a near vacuum environment, you are lessening the aerodynamic drag already. Then if you are investing in making it aerodynamic, then what's the point? Like, you will gain up only a few more speed, kilometer per hour speed. Why do you need to create this? Already you are having a near vacuum environment over here. There is less aerodynamic drag. So if you move a poorly aerodynamic object through it, still it's going to work. Because you end up spending a little bit of more money on this aerodynamic shape.
So you said the pod moves forward using magnets. How does it turn?
How does it
turn?
Turn.
So that's like a single line and three pods go in different directions.
Three pods in
different directions. How do it turn?
See, the system is same. For each pod, see. I didn't explain it. This is one singular hyperloop. This is not exactly a hyperloop, this is a maglev, but the same system is working, but on the top. This is a train, you can see it is turning. How is it turning? See, normally what you have a singular track, 3-4 pods are coming from here, and it's getting the ability to turn. Okay? And this go away like it should go straight. You're telling that how does it turn actually? So when I talked about propulsion, how was it propulsionating? Like by the use of magnets. So at that time we were having a straight track over there by using magnets. It was moving. Now I had asked Parth a question during the presentation. What if this magnet was more powerful than the magnet on the other side? What would happen?
It would turn
towards that side. So it would turn towards that side and the shape of the tube would be made here so that when it is turning, it's not bumping into the tube. It is able to glide smoothly and it can pass. And then obviously that it is going to get straight ahead. So you have the same kind of technology that's using again north pole, south pole, attraction and repulsion. And over here, one magnet is a little bit of powerful to shift it. And moving it from its normal straight, it will shift a little bit. And then it is gradually going to get straight when both the magnets are of equal power. So this is our little baby loop term.
How do they change the power of the magnet? How do they change the power of the magnet?
See, these are electromagnets.
No, but if in the same tube, one tube needs to go forward and one tube needs to turn.
Can you show that?
Wait,
I also want to.
Not this one, bad. This one, system operations. Yeah. So, yeah. So, this.
Here. Can you only play the animation that went? Now, a pod comes. Two quads come like in a same direction. One wants to go straight and one wants to go to the other side. Now, when you turn, you said the magnets become of more powerful magnets. Won't that affect both the quads going straight and going left?
I'll just repeat what I have said. Quads are coming from this angle. Okay. One quad is going straight, and the other quad is going in this angle. What you are trying to say is that if you are having a stronger electromagnet over here than this one, then won't the other wala quad?
Yes. Won't that affect the other wala quad that is going straight?
Okay. Now see, electromagnets are, we know that they are variable in power. If you supply it with more electricity, they will get more magnetism. So there are two theories. Actually, I was trying to research on this, but they are identical for obvious reasons. So there are two theories. First one is that hyperloop go at high speed and they will be departing, like they must be having a few intervals. Like if you there is one quad, you have a gap of 1 minute. Suppose electricity doesn't take a lot of time and electromagnetism doesn't take a lot of time to reduce back.
Change.
And
yes.
So one theory is that
they bring the power back to normal.
Yeah. And they see this one, they get the power back to normal and the other quad can go from low state.
What is Hyperloop doing to make itself accessible? Like it needs a lot of infrastructure. And some countries don't even have proper normal railways. So how is it making it accessible? How is it making it less efficient? They need to put a lot of investment in making the stations, those tubes.
Now the same question I am asking you. See, before I answer you, I will let you tell you a fact.
Horses, I know it is lesser than magnets, but then
no, it's not lesser than magnets.
Magnets.
It's half the tunnel size required. When two maglev trains pass through a tunnel, like one goes from here and one goes from here, from one tunnel, one maglev can move, two hyperloops can move. The same way. From other tunnel, again two hyperloops can move. So what is it? We require less of space. The second is half infrastructure. See, when you are seeing, there are many countries that are not even having
normal
trains. See, there are countries, I agree. But Hyperloop at the moment is in the development stage. Like see, once when the trains, Britishers, when they were ruling over the world, almost all over the world, they started their trains. First in India itself, it started from Mumbai to Thane, the first train.
Yes.
After that, it kept on expanding. So Hyperloop is the same thing. When it's going to be sustainable, it's going to be cheap, then slowly and gradually, see the first train,
it will
evolve slowly. Like first the metro trains, you see. Metro trains are not all over India. First it was only in Delhi, then it came in Mumbai, then it came to different cities all over India. So this is the same thing. Things are quite expensive at the moment. But half the infrastructure cost is compared to the maglev. But at the moment things are expensive, still they are having 27-35% reduction on this infrastructure cost. So slowly and gradually it will develop. Like still there are countries that are not having airports, but chota to hai nahi hai, to chota hai. So this is the same thing. It's in the developing stage. It is estimated by 2050. Like, But at that time, there would be, Hyperloop would be like the latest or with the latest law. But at that time, it would have become a longer mode of transportation by then. And then it would keep on developing like other modes of transportation.